We have a super interesting panel today on effectively AI, generative AI, LLMs, and the differences and the uses. And we'll break the panel up into three categories. First, generative AI and LLMs. Secondarily, compliance and risk management. And thirdly, pitfalls and challenges. We'll try to be topical and keep it high level as there is a wide dispersion of knowledge in the audience. So our panelists today, to the left, we have Ruben Falk of AWS. Then we have Daniel Sandberg of S&P Global. Then we have Martin Oku of TIAA. Then we have Sateesh Kumar of SocGen. I'll start with Ruben. Ruben, if you could just give us a brief sort of sentence on your company, though there's no one who doesn't know it, and then maybe a sentence on what you do there. Thanks.
Yeah, so Ruben Falk, I lead machine learning and generative AI for AWS when it comes to commercialization of those technologies and solutions for financial services. And I spent all my career in capital markets, overlap with Dan at S&P for a good long number of years.
Thanks, Ruben. Dan?
Sure. Dan Sandberg. I oversee the quantamental research team at S&P Global. We think of ourselves as close to an internal client of S&P. We use our data the way we think clients are using the data, and then we document our experiences for client consumption.
Thanks, Dan. Martin?
Martin Ouko, I lead the AI operations at TIAA. TIAA, for those who don't know, we pride ourselves as a big company with a small name. We have more than 1.4 trillion in assets under management, and we are not for profit, but we also say we're not for losses.
Hope not. Thanks, Sateesh, please.
Hi, everyone. This is Sateesh Kumar Challa. I head the digital transformation office at SocGen, Societe Generale. It's a French bank. It's one of the top 20 largest banks in the world. My focus areas are risk and compliance.
Yeah. Thanks. So let's start with the first third of the panel, assuming we get through all thirds. Generative AI and LLMs. For those that are less familiar or just learning or getting up to speed and maybe more traditional discretionary or, old school, so to speak, investors, what are LLMs and what is generative AI for novices? Who likes to take that one to start? Anyway,
Ruben, I could go a little bit. I mean, so generative AI or large language models in particular allow you to work with textual data, right? And so when I speak to model providers and I speak to software providers that are building the orchestration layer for large language models, they're saying that the data they're working with, textual data, has never been databased for the most part, right? So there is probably as much unstructured textual data out there as there is structured data, except the unstructured textual data has not ever been databased, never really been used for systematic processes, right? So that's sort of what LLMs or large language models allow you to do, at least in part, is work with textual data, of which there's a lot, and be able to process it and extract meaning and value from it in a way that is, you know, somewhat revolutionary, right? Because it doubles the amount of data, at least, that we're now all able to work with. That's sort of one explanation, but feel free to follow up.
Go on, Martin.
So think about LLMs. They're called large language models. Like this kid that you take to college, take through different stages of school, learns all languages. It spends so much time understanding languages, and then now you can train to specialize in some kind of area. So LLMs are models that are built or trained on a huge corpus of data, scraped through the internet and other places. And then once it learns the language, it's fluent enough, then you can now get it to do things like you can ask it questions. You can ground in context and tell it to do some things, do some summarization and stuff like that. That separates itself from ML, which is a method of building, one of the many methods of building models like LLMs, which is machine learning, which is the process of just taking, like teaching a dog new tricks. You show a dog, you tell him, this is what I want you to do. And when you look at this, this is what it means. You show it a few examples, and then it tests it on it to see if it does, it learns, and then that becomes the model.
Thanks. Do you want to add something, Sateesh?
I mean, just to extend his kids analogy, I just want to make it even more easier to understand. Yes, I mean, generative AI is the overarching thing. Like, you have AI, you have deep learning, which is a subdivision of AI. Now you have generative AI, and large language models are a subdivision of generative AI, right? And just to extend this kids analogy, it is creative, right? It is not anymore the existing one, but you are trying to create something new with the LLMs. And because it is creative, obviously it is unpredictable too. So I just want to leave that thought.
Anything you want to add, Daniel?
Sure, yeah. So I always like to try and develop an intuition with an analogy. I liked yours. But in preparation, I did what I'm sure most would do, which I asked ChatGPT for an analogy. And it came back with something I thought was pretty cool. It said, AI is like the chef in the kitchen. Machine learning is the cookbook. The data streams are the ingredients. Generative AI is like a talented sous chef that's a little bit egotistical. It doesn't want to follow the recipe book. It wants to come up with its own recipes based on its understanding of the ingredients. So I thought that was apt. To extend on that a bit, I'd say the benefit of being able to go off recipe book is probably also the biggest risk. It's as good to go a little bit outside the recipe book, to be way off the recipe book, probably a little dangerous. And then I would also say, of late, generative AI and language models, particularly large language models, have become very intertwined, but they're very much not the same thing. Generative AI is about generating new information based on the training set data and some prompts. Large language models are about understanding language and, in most cases, assessing the probability of a particular sequence of words. So one of the non-generative AI uses is to assess the likelihood of a particular string of words, which could be hard-coded in a sense, right? So, for example, if you were to train a language model in 2018 based on data up to that point, and then use it to assess transcripts of earnings calls in 2020, it would pick up on terms like coronavirus and COVID-19 as very improbable words to appear in a transcript. And so it turns out the improbable language that appears in news and regulatory documents and transcripts of calls, that usually tends to be the most interesting. So very much separate concepts. I'm sure we'll get more into it.
Yeah, thank you, Daniel. And that GPT answer is pretty darn good, right? Not bad.
We should have had a GPT up here. We could have just...
Yeah, exactly. Right. All right. Not to belabor it, but... Martin started to go on this. Anyone else care to add anything on the other, any other nuances or differences without getting too granular or technical on the differences between the sort, because the differences between traditional, or I shouldn't say traditional, but machine learning's been around for 70 years since post-World War II. So it's really not new, and it's had many boom and busts. And, you know, to that extent, do you all think that this is sort of like one of those booms over the last 70 years, or do you think it's really different this time, which so often it isn't? But yeah, go on, Daniel.
That's a great point. It's not new, and generative AI is not new, and language modeling is not new. The models that we've seen of late, I think, are an order of magnitude more sophisticated than, you know, anything that I've personally seen before. We also have, with the now in the public domain, ChatGPT, a generalized large language model. So it's been trained on this really, really broad corpus. And so it's not a special purpose model, which is what a lot of other models were. But these are not new technologies in and of themselves. I think what is new is that we're probably seeing for the first time the democratization of those algorithms, and that's an inflection point.
The other thing I would add is, you know, you have this confluence of record low processing and storage costs. You have record amount of data, which is effectively digitized and accessible digitally now. You know, you have this machine learning working, and you have data science. So you have this confluence of four factors that has really facilitated this democratization of it. But let's shift into, so excluding compliance and risk management for the moment, because we'll get to that momentarily. But in from each of your sort of day jobs, so to speak, or your careers or what you're doing at Amazon, TIAA, S&P, SocGen, respectively. Ruben, why don't you start in terms of your use cases and approaches at AWS?
Yeah, I mean, there are sort of three general use cases that we tend to focus on and see our customers implement, right? One is around sort of customer interaction, right? So think about a financial advisor having a conversation with an investor, the conversation being transcribed in near real time, the transcription giving rise to certain queries fired off against the knowledge base articles that are relevant to the conversation come back. And in the past, that's sort of where it ended, right? Now the financial advisor could maybe pass on those articles after the call, but now with generative AI, those articles, the conversation points or new information to the conversation can be summarized in real time and relayed back to the customer, to the retail investor or professional investor in near real time, right? So that's one use case. And somebody's compared that to, it's like playing chess with Kasparov whispering in your ear. And so I think, going back to your earlier question a little bit, is that I do think it's different in the sense that these use cases are unlocking, or the use cases that are being unlocked by this technology are very, very different and somewhat revolutionary, right? And in that sense, it's incremental, but it's incremental in a very sort of significant way.
Thanks. We'll go to Sateesh for the moment.
So in terms of use cases, again, coming from a banking background and within the investment banking space, I see a huge potential in terms of ideating the research aspect of investment research. So that is a prime use case which is being used, of course, with the risk and compliance factor, which we'll discuss in a short while from now. But that is one use case. The second is also from an advisory standpoint. You see generative AI primarily helping in terms of lessening the bandwagon of inquiries which keep coming in terms of product curation, in terms of channeling these requests internally. Thereby, you are able to actually get the context from wide varieties of sources of data, and then internalizing that and training on your internal data so that you can have a prompt to access that data within the organization. That's the second primary use case which I have seen. The third is in terms of generating documents. The documents could be in terms of origination of any deals. So that is where, again, it is not in a production kind of state, but it would give you a good starter point based of all the facts which is available within the organization. So that's a great use case which I've seen using generative AI.
And Martin, yeah.
Yeah, I think what Ruben and Sateesh kind of covered basically what we see out there. But I also want to say that we're moving away from fine-tuning models into grounding models. So, for example, your 10Qs and 10Ks that usually takes a lot of time for analysts to pull through and summarize and figure out, look at the footnotes and synthesize and figure out what that means. Generative AI can now be used or are now being used to be able to take those reports, synthesize them and feed and within a very short period of time summaries or queries that can answer questions that usually would take weeks to do. Other places we see them used is in fraud analytics. Usually, for example, credit card cases where you want real time, so you push real transaction data from locations and see if there are any anomalies. It picks out, you can use generative AI for that. You can also, we've seen it used in complaints identification and routing. Today, FINRA requires most financial service companies to report on complaints. So being able to, in real time, figure out whether it's from a portal or from calls, from the call center, being able to figure out, isolate complaints, summarize them, and ship them out to the right people to resolve them, and in parallel, ship them to FINRA for reporting purposes. Those are some areas we see proliferate use of AI. And we begin to see that AI is, especially generative AI, becoming more of a commodity than specialized tool in the last few weeks.
Thanks. And last but not least, Daniel.
I think my co-panelists have touched on the main use cases, document generation. I'm not sure if anybody mentioned code generation, but I'll throw that one out there. I think from an investment management standpoint, what's most interesting to me is the ability to extract features from text. As Ruben mentioned, there's long been recognition that a lot of information is not in a database format. It's unstructured textual content. And how you pull out the meaningful information from that has required a lot of thought and care. So I'll give you a concrete example. My team did some work looking at the risk and MD&A section in 10Ks, as Martin mentioned, and we found that by and large, most companies copy and paste those sections from one, particularly risk, from one filing to the next, unless something has really changed. And so just looking at the magnitude of changes in a rules-based way, going long names that have preserved their language and shorting names that have modified their language is an efficacious trading strategy and a backtest. That's without any context as to what actually changed. Now, with a model like large language modeling, a generative AI large language model, we could actually apply context to that and I'm sure improve the signal substantially.
But how, I mean, like if I think, so I started a company called Move 30, or co-founded a company called Move 37 in 2016, focused on managers using machine learning and alternative data. And they were using NLP to do that. I mean, how is that different, or is it materially different than that? In other words, you know, you could use NLP and you say, if there's a liability mentioned or red flag or reserve, or, you know, you put in these sort of triggers, keywords, which people like myself had previously done as fundamental discretionary analysts. How is that different than just using NLP X years ago versus today using LLMs?
Sure. So, I mean, if we take the example of a rules-based approach where we're flagging particular words, maybe we're even, in many cases, natural language processing will map language words to different sentiment and then attach sentiment to those words and topics that are mentioned along with those words. But if you think about the fail rate of that approach compared to what you might get from a human analyst actually reading the document, understanding it, understanding the changes in context of other things that are going on. I think everybody would agree that the human is going to do a better job assessing the meaningfulness of that update or change or mention. If we think about the rules-based sort of word list mapping approach on one side of the spectrum and the human on the other side, the AI models are starting to move towards the middle.
Thanks. Anyone want to add anything? Or yeah, go on, Sateesh.
I just want to add one thing here. When you compare with the existing NLP models with Gen AI kind of thing, I see a key differentiator. Earlier, you knew what was the use case, and you are really targeting with a limited scope, right? And you are really trying to curate, and of course, there's a lot of false positives. With generative AI, the possibility is what could be that word even before the human in the loop really can predict that. So in a way, you are trying to identify using the sensitivity analysis. You risk rank those sensitivities. Now, none of the analysts would have thought that that could be a trend because it was never accessible. That is the possibility with generative AI. Of course, there would be a lot of false alarms out there, but that needs to be fine-tuned, and that's the difference I see.
Maybe just to ask, I think for investment management purposes, you know, generative AI is mostly used right now to augment or improve the efficiency of human analysts, human portfolio advisors, and so forth. Right? They're not really being used to replace them. And I'll give you a good example. So with, and this is actually a public reference, you can look up the video if you would like. So Bridgewater went public with AWS and Anthropic about a use case where their analysts or portfolio managers can use a system whereby they enter natural language queries into that system to analyze data. So they can say something like, graph me the performance of this stock or this strategy, or graph me the Sharpe ratios, what have you. And it'll the system will write code. It'll clarify whether it understood the question correctly, and then it'll write code to generate the visualizations that'll answer those questions, right? And Bridgewater has come out and said they're not looking really to replace, you know, the senior analysts or the portfolio managers, but they think they have a solution now that actually is a really good sort of potential replacement or competition for a first-year analyst. And they're going to try to push that to, you know, a second-year analyst, right? So that's how they see it, right? Not necessarily as a replacement for sort of a quant strategy, even though I think what Dan is saying is that you can do that too. But where a lot of the efficiencies and use cases are coming from is just providing that sort of support system in the form of something that can do what a first-year analyst can do, but much more efficiently and cheaper and so forth.
Right, because based on what, for example, Bridgewater's a good example, having been a former investor there, and based on what's, you know, public information from them, their models are all human generated and based on humans. Like Bridgewater is not historically, nor likely, I think, in the near future, to use neural nets or deep learning or, you know, have the computer create models they don't understand. Their whole premise is based on understanding the global economy, economics, financial systems, money supply, and making that into a model. So what you say makes sense as to the way they would, for example, apply it. Yeah, go on, Daniel.
Yeah, I just wanted to clarify. So by no means am I saying that these models are generating trading strategies. What I am saying is at some point you need to extract from unstructured data a label or a normalized tag. And so that's an application where these models do extremely well. So if you wanted to know, for example, whether a company is talking about reducing their inventory due to supply chain, supply chain tensions easing, that's very hard to extract in a rules-based way by mapping particular words, something contextual like that. Whereas with a large language model, extremely straightforward.
Thanks. Let's see. I mean, we have so much to cover and so little time left. I guess why don't we shift to compliance and risk management so we at least touch on all three topics briefly. Let's talk about the compliance risks with AI. Who wants to kick that one off? Yes, Sateesh? So,
compliance and risk, I mean, it's a huge area, of course. I mean, based off the nature of models and thanks to the regulations we have currently in place, prior to any AI regulation which we have, we are governed by SR 11.7 from a banking financial supervision perspective, where every model which is built has to have some clarity in terms of the data which is getting inputted into the models and then and how the model really transforms that data and then how the output of the model really comes out of this whole whole chain of model, right? So that piece has to be transparent, and of course the explainability is a natural byproduct of it, and that's the major area which needs to be focused and which is needed for all the regulators in general. How the model makes the decisions and what are the guardrails in place is one of the big topic, and once you get into those territory, you need to prove the data lineage aspect and data privacy. There's not been a breach to any sort of intellectual property, so on and so forth.
Thanks.
Yeah, maybe I can just add to that. I mean, and very similar to what you just said, I was with a big investment bank, like a top five global investment bank the other week, and they were talking about the fact that they need to develop model risk management processes for generative AI, and they just don't have them today, right? I mean, they have model risk management for traditional machine learning, and so if you want to put a traditional machine learning process into production, there's a review board, there's a set process you have to go through. People know they bring all the test results, all the evidence of lack of bias and so forth. They can get their traditional machine learning model approved by the model review board. But for generative AI, they don't even have the rules established, right? So actually scaling, putting these things into production is a problem from that perspective.
I agree completely. I mean, I think I was referring loosely the term AI in general, but for generative AI, in fact, within the AI space itself, it's not yet standardized on how the models have to be developed. There are no model development lifecycle standards in general across the industry. When you compare with the software development lifecycle, I think we are far behind in terms of standardization. And obviously on generative AI, it's tough to really get to that standards, as you can see that every prompt can really change the whole output, and there's no way to trace back that. So I think it's still an evolving space for us to really trace back those decisions on and contextualize for each prompt how the output has been attained and trace that clarity. Yeah.
Yeah, because that reminds me of, you know, the SEC is recently cracking down on, for example, accountability with ESG. And that, like, so to me, that sounds like something that will very much be in the SEC's crosshairs in terms of, if particularly if you're using generative AI or LLMs to make decisions or recommendations, sounds like something the SEC is going to want to see a rationale for, what data was used, how you arrived at it. Did someone want to add to that?
I mean, a couple of things. I think both Ruben and Sateesh making great points about the process. And I would say that as we start to see the space democratize more, we get more third-party tools that users can just pick up and use, it's going to exacerbate the problem, because those folks won't have in-house, you know, a advisory board maybe that approves AI models. And then to your point, Michael, you know, yes, the SEC came out with a statement, I think it was back in over the summer, June or July. And then I don't know if folks know this, but this was exactly 1 week ago today, Monday of last week, President Biden issued an executive order around AI. Yeah. And so, you know, point being, this is a very fast evolving space and quickly changing space. So really, you know, if you're going to adopt the technology, you need to be able to monitor and adapt to that.
Martin, yeah.
Yeah, there's multiple ways to approach this. Most organizations start from a policy perspective, develop AI policy and frameworks. And that's what I've been working on, we've been working on over the last year or so. This year was bringing some of the best practices from DevOps, from software development lifecycle, into model development lifecycle. And embedding those policy standard, the standards that come out of those policies into the process, as opposed to inspecting them into the product. So you can start from there. But the biggest challenge to this space is that, like you said, it evolves real fast. It's at warp speed. So that legislation and regulation is not keeping up with it. So we have to self-regulate. So it requires certain things. So you think of AI as this kid that can learn bad habits. So you build a good model today. There's no guarantee that the model is going to generalize well 6 months from now. Like some models we built before COVID, after COVID, they started drifting. There are certain things that happen, especially within...
Effectively you'd unknowingly, unintentionally, it overfit based on the recent past?
Yeah, but because models learn new tricks. Today, most models can use reinforcement learning. So if you have a model that is exposed to the public, and it learns from public, and it gets better over time, it also has the risk of getting worse over time. There's also the risk that the data that was used to build it had its own inherent bias in it. And there's one component that's always missing, that most people who build AI models are technologists. So most technologists don't have the well-rounded training to be able to be self-aware. So some of our biases will invariably bleed into those models. And when these models become black boxes, then it becomes a special challenge, because that risk is now transferred to the organization that has deployed that model that could create problems down the line.
Yeah, did anyone want to add anything to that, or should we continue? Okay. This sort of second segment of this discussion is compliance and risk management. But let's segue to risk management. So how can AI bolster risk management? Who wants to kick that one off? Anyone?
I can go.
Yeah, go on, Sateesh.
So I think it gets very quickly into the risk space. I mean, the same thing which we just talked about can easily be connected, like any of these infringement to data. And if you are in the news, it is reputational risk, as simple as that, right? So you get into a space where you were not able to address your models, and if it is not stable enough and the decisions you can't defend, your brand is really impacted. So that is one huge risk. And then you have problems in terms of ESG, as you just raised. So ESG is another risk stripe, which is heavily catching up in terms of the sustainable aspects of these Gen AI solutions in general. So that's another risk which I can definitely iterate on. Yeah.
Thanks. Anyone? Yeah, Martin.
How does it bolster risk management?
Yeah.
A lot of times today, our risk management process are more reactive than proactive. So we all have first level, second level, and third level of risk management. But a lot of those times, there are policies in books, and there's no way to vet if these things are happening. So you may randomly sample and see where it's a problem, or maybe you find out these problems once they happen. Using AI, for example, to go into your call center and look at how your financial advisors dishing out advice, and in real time picking up potential risk in terms of things that might not line up with regulations, is one way where AI can go a long way in bolstering risk management. Another place is when you think about today, when you want to, for example, give loan to somebody, there's asymmetric information. Usually people only give you what is best for them to get the loan. Then to a given extent, you can only go so far to find out. And that leads to adverse selection, which could eventually lead to moral hazard when they cannot pay the loan. But if you can use AI to do more and be able to map and predict with a given level of accuracy that these are good prospects for the loan, and you do it at warp speed as opposed to taking so much. So AI would work very well. One thing I would caution for is that, again, going back to the data imbalance, there's inherent bias in the data already. So being able to build models that you can, that are transparent enough, that you have ethical people building these models, that ethical decisions are made in building these models, will go a long way in mitigating the risk of this bringing inherent risk of, just redlining some people like you've seen in the past. So those are the areas that you would want to pay attention to. But it will be great to use for example, to augment credit scoring and stuff like that.
Thanks.
So one quick point which I would like to make, again, connecting to the risks portion, especially on the financial crimes risk. Because we are talking about generative AI here, we see a lot of potential in terms of the risks which is out there is never linear. And as a result, having signals coming out of the raw transaction or the raw activity is one of the primary areas where it really strengthens the risk program in general to identify newer scenarios, newer indicators which never existed, because your existing processes were always rule-based and traditional flags which have been identified. Now we are in a territory which is uncharted, and that is the huge potential how it strengthens the risks domain.
I think Ruben wanted to add something.
Yeah, I mean, I think in terms of sort of how we're seeing it used, it's mostly, again, in the sort of augmenting what our customers are doing already, right? So for instance, suspicious activity reports are being automated, compliance research is being automated and so forth. In terms of how our customers are trying to avoid these risks from manifesting, it's a couple different ways, right? One is that they train models specifically on their own data where they're completely in control of the training data. And so we have a large investment bank, for instance, that their institutional research portal, all the summaries there are generated by a large language model. And they used a small large language model, open source, and they trained it on all their research, and they were able to sort of control for hallucinations because they really controlled the training data. They were also able to get the summaries written in the voice of their research, right? So being sort of very meticulous about the training data is a way of potentially avoiding the pitfalls of hallucinations. So they could actually offer this out to the institutional customers. So and then the other way to try to avoid sort of hallucinations is by, you know, bringing the fact base on which the answers are based to the model, and then checking what the model is giving you back in terms of the answer and whether that, you know, you can trace it back to the fact base that you gave it. So those are some of the ways that our customers are trying to, you know, stay in line with compliance.
Yeah, I think that's, again, that relates to the SEC. I think that's going to be integral going forward, that you do have this sort of understandability and traceability, because my sense is, based on seeing how this SEC has been acting over the past X years, they're going to want to see that you appreciate that. You were going to add something, Daniel?
I think Ruben's point is a good one. These models are not necessarily capable of doing, at least right now, capable of pulling out something that a human, you know, probably couldn't do, but they're much faster at it, right? And so to the same extent that you might be processing a few records, you could process now a lot of records, and you can do it in a way that's systematic and normalize that output. So the same way that you might be pulling features out of, for example, a large corpus of textual data for the purposes of alpha, you could do the same thing for risk.
Thanks. So Ruben kindly took us into the third category, which are pitfalls and challenges. So we'll just continue briefly there in the last few minutes. Martin, you alluded to this earlier in the panel. You know, are the models stable? And you sort of alluded to this sort of temporary unintentional overfitting, perhaps during the pandemic or post-pandemic, that they no longer worked as well or worked. And I mean, you know, if you look at investors, right, what worked during the pandemic generally didn't work after the pandemic. But shifting to the AI models and the what we're discussing, how do you deal with that? How do you prevent overfitting?
There are multiple ways of preventing overfitting. It's bringing more data, allowing not to use more data to allow your model to learn from more varied data set or data and do better. You can also do a lot of cross-validation, getting data that the model hasn't seen. You can also use ensembles. You can use multiple models that vote on the weights, and then you take what the votes are. So those are multiple ways, but I want to take it in a different direction. I think one of the pitfalls of AI today is how the industry looks at AI. Industry looks at AI, like you indicated, as something that is going to displace the human. And when I see AI, I see augmented intelligence and not artificial intelligence. This is where you bring the best of human and the best of technology, put them together. Then you push the production possibility frontier. Technology can only do so much. So being able to find what technology does so well and what some of the most specialized people do so well and put them together, make them friends, work together, that will make 1 + 1 add up to 3 as opposed to adding up to 2 or less if they work individually. So I see organizations that spend a lot of time trying to use AI as a way to create alpha, but also drive human aspect of it out of it, will in the long run lose. But organizations that think of AI as an ally, as a way to expand that production possibility frontier, will go a long way in increasing their productivity and expanding the pie. And this is, I'm saying this because, you know, I don't want to see AI 5-7 years from now, it has failed in a large way because of the way you approach it. So that's one pitfall that industry leaders should be thinking about.
Thanks. You know, to sort of wrap up the panel, because I think we have maybe a minute or so left, if each of you, is there anything you'd like to mention that maybe we thought we'd have time to discuss or you didn't, or that you'd like to impress upon the audience? Anyone like to start that? Yeah, Ruben.
I think one interesting thing we didn't talk much about is this idea that, you know, large language models, they can write code. Not only can they write code, you can have agents that execute that code. Not only can they do that, they can potentially improve on the code that they are writing, right? So that you can write a code improver where the large language model is actually improving on the code improver itself, right? So So there is this idea that large language models potentially could be sort of self-teaching, right, and self-evolving. So, and you know, there and there's people. There are some people that are like, you know, this is going to be the end of mankind. There are other people like, this is totally overblown. I mean, I think over the last probably couple of months, I've started to appreciate that there's something there in terms of, you know, this ability to code and execute code and rewrite the code and learn from, you know, experience to improve its own sort of capabilities. I think it's sort of both super interesting and also a little scary.
Thanks, Daniel. Just very brief, because we have, I think, less than a minute.
Sure, I'll be quick. So Ruben said it's important to know your training data, and I think that is something that I would like to talk more about if we had the time. I would say, you know, with these generalized models that are trained on these huge corpuses of data, when you're talking to a generative large language model trained on a really broad corpus, you're effectively talking to the corpus. And so one thing that I've seen pop up, there's actually been some academic papers on this, is that please and thank you tends to matter when you're talking to generative large language models. You get better answers. And I've thought about that for a really long time, and I think the reason that people see that is when you use professional diction and polite language, you're effectively talking to those parts of the corpus, whereas if you talk like you're in a Reddit forum, you're talking to those parts of the corpus, right? So an interesting feature of the models.
Well, I might argue the opposite on that, though, because if you have highly technical people in a Reddit forum, I don't know, are they really constantly saying please and thank you, or are they more to the point?
That's my point, is that the social media probably isn't the same thing as like a transcript of this conference.
All right. I've been told that we are done, but look, I'd like to thank VDOC, BERYL Elites, the panelists, and the audience. I think that was a super interesting way to kick off the event and the conference on generative AI, LLMs, and you can all discuss it subsequently with the panelists. Thank you.